theme of the book of James is real faith produces genuine works. In other words, if the person that has found real faith, they will genuinely, it worked when I left the house, genuinely walked in. So he's telling these guys who are scattered, he's telling you and me that if we are saying that Jesus is our Lord and Savior, then let your life show that. Show that it's true. And so as we begin the study this morning, we're going to find James's writing to these struggling Christians and us, the trials that come in order to strengthen our faith, not to weaken it, to foster our character, not to diminish it, and to quicken our attentiveness to his still small voice. So James helps us to know God better and explains why God helps to experience very times of testing. So you can open up your Bibles to chapter 1. We're going to read through the text. I'm reading through the New American Standard, and then when we conclude with the text, I'll pray. James, a bond servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes who are dispersed abroad, greetings. Consider it all joy, my brethren, when you encounter various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance, and let endurance have its perfect result. Not that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing, but if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives all generously without reproach, and it will be given to them, him. But he must ask in faith without any doubting, for the one who doubts is like the surf of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind. For the man ought not to expect that he will receive anything from the Lord, being a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. But the brother of humble circumstances is to glory in his high position, and the rich man is to glory in his humiliation, because like flowering grass he will pass away. For the sun rises with a scorching wind and withers with the grass, and its flower falls off, and the beauty of its appearance is destroyed. So too the rich man in the midst of his pursuits will fade away. Blessed is the man who perseveres under trial, for once he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to those who love him. Father, I just lift up the time that we have to share this morning. Lord, it's a privilege to me to be here. And Lord, I just ask that your word will be just really rich today. Lord, that you, through your Holy Spirit, will speak and just use me as your mouthpiece. Lord, that you will convict, if conviction is what you want to do, that you will edify, if that's what you want to do, that, you know, whatever each and every individual needs here today, it's my prayer that you will speak specifically to them through the power of your Spirit. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. It was pain that knocked on my door and said that she should come to stay. Though I would not welcome her and bade her to go away, she entered in. And like my own shade, she followed after me. And like her stabbing, stinging sword, no moment was I free. In the words of that poet or that artist, he describes a miserable hurting condition. The condition is simply speaking about troubles that just won't go away. The words of that poem describe many who I know. Most of all, you know, my wife could have written that poem and have meant every single word of it. But the person that that poem describes is really not a unique individual. It describes every person in here, and probably everyone that will ever listen to this message. It describes you during multiple points in your lives. If you can relate to what I'm saying, can I hear an amen? Yeah. It describes everybody. The first truth that we want to point out is mentioned in verse 2, which says, "Consider it all joy, my brethren, when you encounter various trials." Trials or troubles are inevitable. Don't miss this, or you won't have a basis for like building on the rest of what we have to say. Isn't it interesting that James does not say, count it all joy if you encounter various trials, does it? That would be like saying, be prepared if you have to pay taxes. Or it would be like saying, if you were going to, you know, if I was to die someday, I'd be prepared for that. You know, it's like when you are going to die. You know, it's just as inevitable as taxes and death. And so trials are coming in your life, and trials are inevitable. It's interesting to me that the word various in verse 2 comes from the word originally in the Greek that means spread out. It means, you know, all different shapes, all different colors, you know, various sizes. But all of life is like dotted with trials. And the most familiar response that God hears from his child is, why? And it really should never come from our lips. You know, it actually reminds me of a story. It's about a fellow that was coming home on the subway, and he was like prone to motion sickness, and he had a big lunch that day, and he'd gone back to the office, and he had worked part of the day, and now he was coming home on the subway, and you know, he was like jammed into the subway as the very last person to get on that car that he got in. And so you can just picture it. He was face right up against the window, and he's standing there facing right up against that window, and things are just flashing by his face like 90 miles per hour. And he's getting sicker and sicker and sicker as time goes on. And so the next stop comes up, and it wasn't his stop to get off, you know, but so the subway stops, the doors open, and there's a guy standing there on the platform ready to get on, and as the doors open, out comes his lunch all over this guy standing there on the platform. And so then the doors close, and the subway takes off, and the guy standing there on the platform, and he turns around to the dude behind him and he goes, why me? Well, that's a perfect illustration of what James is saying here. Don't respond when trials are saying, why me? Why this? Or why now? James says, trials are inevitable. And if the door doesn't open on you this time, it is going to open on you the next time. So be ready, because trials are inevitable. Now, the second truth that we need to understand is trials have a purpose. Now, if you get this one down, you will be way ahead of the average Christian. Trials have a purpose. And James doesn't leave us questioning what that purpose is. He gives us the initial result, and then he gives us the ultimate result. And the pathway of tests lead us to the immediate and the ultimate results. What would that be? Well, let's look at verse 3. Knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance. Now, there is the first purpose. God designed specific things to stretch us, to force us into a corner, that we cannot get out of. And God says, now, as long as you're in the corner, there are some things that I want to teach you. First, I want you to learn endurance. The Greek word translated endurance comes from a combination of two words. And when put together, they literally mean to abide under. And we would say, in our terms, we would say, hey, hang in there. So the trials that come to teach us on how to hang in there, and there, when there is no answer on the surface. And now, if you would, I just want you to think back to this past week. You know, or maybe if you lived a really blessed life, think of a trial in the past month. Not one experience that you have given thought to in these past few seconds came by accident. It was designed by God. And the first result that God wanted to see was the production of endurance. We would call it patience. So, how are you doing in this test as the result of, you know, whatever trouble it was? You see, that's why it won't go away. That's why it's still there, because of the presence of impatience, because of the lack of endurance. And James says now this, he says that the testing of your faith produces endurance. Now, before I move on to the second result, I want you to study verse 3 with your eyes for a moment. Look at it. I want you to look at the words testing of your faith. You know, we frequently take tests as a personal offense, and we should look upon tests as servants that bring about the circumstance to teach us something. And it isn't we who are the target of God's test. What does it say? It says it's our faith that is the target of the test. Like a great massive rubber band, you know, God begins to stretch our faith. And he pulls at it, and he pushes, and he mashes, and he squeezes, and he stretches again, and until finally we begin to be a little more flexible. And we give a little where we didn't before. And by, God is hoping that we are able to feel more comfortable, more patient under the load. You know, that's the idea here. And so, as a matter of fact, he takes a positive approach to it. Notice the word testing in verse 3. Testing of your faith. It comes from the word dokimos, which means to be approved. You know, if you've done any study in archaeology or you have traveled to the Near East, you would know that many jugs, pots, or vessels that they have dug up, they have been marked underneath them. They're marked Dokamas. It was an ancient way of expressing approval of a vessel that went through the fire, through the furnace, without cracking. Now, those vessels that went through the furnace and cracked or that chipped, they would be put on the budget shelf and sold for much less. Those vessels that were more valuable, they were labeled Dokamas, through the fire. They were approved through the furnace. That's the word here. And so it's a test, and we get to see God's approval. Now, God flings upon us a particular kind of test, and therefore we're done with that test. Another one comes, you know, and then he corners us and he says, "Now, my child, I am working with you so that you might know that this particular area of your life, it needs some attention. So, hey, don't run, you know, because I'm going to catch you. And when I catch you, you're going to have another circumstance that you can't get out of." And so you're cornered, and the Christian begins to get the message. Hopefully he does. And he says, "It is inevitable." He says, "This is purposeful. The situation is a servant." And you see, God doesn't manifest himself as a human in form, and he doesn't like strike us on the face. He comes in a form of circumstances and trials. And in all different messages, God says to you, now that I have your attention, let's get some approval out of you. Let's get some of this patience underway. Let's see you stretched to the realm of adversity so that you will now begin to be patient, that you will show endurance. But you know, that's not all. That's just the first quiz. That's just the result of the initial part of the test. There's something more than that. Verse 4, it says, and he goes on, not only that your faith produces endurance, the testing of your faith, but let endurance have its perfect result. It's like stacking up a row of dominoes. You ever do that when you're a kid? I have fun doing that as an adult. You stack up a row of dominoes, and you can put them in all kinds of formations that you want. You hit the first one, and then just one goes on out of the number. It's fun to watch. And so God says, I have stacked up a chain of events here. And that chain of events is going to take place. And he says, it's my finger that's going to push that first one. And that first one is endurance. And when endurance takes place, it bumps into maturity. And as maturity leads on its course, you can become a person with great character. And so the people I know who are people of great character are the people that have learned to handle life in the furnace. And I assume that's probably likely the same for you guys. You know, it could be the mother that is able to say to God, "You gave, you took away, blessed be your name." It's the father who comes home after having done the very best he could, and he has lost his job, and he says to his family, he says, let's get together tonight and thank God for this opportunity to trust him. It's the teenager who says, I will not give up my principles. I will not give up my standard, even though right now it seems that I'm not liked by anybody. You see, it's this marvelous quality of maturity that emerges when we are patient under the load. And so let me say at the outset that when troubles come, they don't come as an enemy. They come as a servant. They come as God's messenger with a note in their hand. And when you open it, it says, this is for your patience. And ultimately, this is for your character. Your character development in the realm of maturity. Now the question arises, well, how can I rise above my situation? I don't want to drop out, I don't want to quit, I don't want to stop short, so what are some techniques that will help me handle circumstances like this? Well, in these same verses, with these same ones that we just looked at, I think there are three words that will give us some guidelines to help us with that. So let's go back there. Verse 2, look at the word consider. Verse 3, know. And verse 4, let. Now let's put them in the same letter. Maybe it'll help us to remember them. Consider, comprehend, and cooperate. So when trials come, the very first thing to do is to consider those trials with a certain mindset. And that mindset is joy. And frankly, it's contrary to our normal response. Our normal response is like the fellow on the subway. Why me? Why now? Why not someone else? And God says, no. When the test comes, consider it all joy. Now, the etymology of the word translated consider is interesting. It means to lead the way into something. It is used for the person that was at the beginning of a line and leading the way or a procession. Kind of like following the leader. You know, it's the leader. And so the leading thought that we are to go into is a reaction to a trial, is to be thoughts that are positive. You know, thoughts like, God has a reason. He has this for my good. He knows that I need it. And I say with joy, Lord, come teach me through this experience. Now, I grant you that at this moment, if your response to testing is that, you are a rare individual. You're in for some of the most exciting lessons that God could ever teach his children. Now, let's look at the next word, know. Or comprehend. In order to consider my trial with a certain mindset, I have to have a comprehension of the good of that trial. I have to realize that it is not for my bad, that it is for my good. That it's not to see me drown, it is to see me swim. And it is to approve my faith, like the vessel in the furnace, while it is there in all that heat. The potter does not say, let's see how much heat it'll take before it cracks. No, he doesn't say that. He says, it's not cracking. And when the furnace dies down, he lifts it out with pleasure and he goes, Dokimos. Consider, comprehend. And he comprehends that plan that God has. And the third is to cooperate. Now, don't fight. He says, let it have its perfect result. Let it have its perfect result. Cooperate. Frankly, I think verse 4 fits in with verses 9, 10, and 11. It seems that the word let is a narrative connective link. And so let me show you. Verse 4. Let endurance have its perfect result. Now let me paraphrase 9 through 11 for you. Take the brother of low circumstance. Let him glory in the position that he has in Christ. And let's let the rich man glory also. Not in what he possesses, but even though he is rich, he is the object of God's care. And his riches may pass, but he stands the test. Even in the midst of his pursuits, they will fade away, but let that man also cooperate. And so I want to take a moment, and I want to leave James 1 for a second and look at the screen at 1 Peter chapter 5. And I want to get a little practical about this. This is 1 Peter 5. It's in verse 6. They're familiar words, but I think I've like dug a little bit deeper than I ever have before. So let's get some insight on this together. It says, verse 6, therefore, humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. So 1 Peter 5, 6 is a command. It says, humble yourself. It means to cooperate. It means to yield. And that he may exalt you in the proper time. But let's not dwell on that part. Let's look at the mighty hand of God. And Peter says to the suffering saint, and that's the theme of 1 Peter, by the way. Peter says, God's hand is on your circumstance. Humble yourself. He says, don't fight. That's the hand of God. And, well, we have to consider. So what do we see on a hand? Well, there are fingers, right? So what can we do with fingers? Well, we can touch with them. We can shake another person's hand. I'd have to squeeze a little bit to shake a person's hand. You can pinch, can't you? God's mighty hand is engaged in pinching us. Let me name some areas. Some of you may be in a job and it's not fulfilling to you. You know, it is where God wants you, though, right now, at this season in your life. But it's not fulfilling. And, you know, it's boring. And people around you are just annoyed. You know, maybe you're feeling underpaid. Whatever the situation is, God is squeezing and he's pinching. And maybe, you know, maybe there's unfair treatment going on. But that's the squeezing hand of God. And some of you might be in a situation in school that seems, you know, terribly unfulfilling. Every day is one grind after another, and you're missing the forest of the future through the trees of today. And so you're living that way under the mighty hand of God, and you feel that you don't have the academic ability to meet the demands of that school. That's the mighty hand of God. He knows that. God isn't saying in heaven, oh my, hey, I didn't realize that you would be in such a circumstance this year. God's saying, no, that's exactly where I wanted you. There are other situations that are completely unbearable. You know, being a pastor isn't always the easiest thing in the world. I'm often faced with people coming to me with impossible circumstances, seeking insight in how to handle them. And you know the very best way out from that mighty hand of God? The way to handle it is to yield, to give in. You know, I have a really good friend. He's been working his whole life as a real estate broker. Been really successful. But a few years ago when the real estate market took a dump, it was the hand of God squeezed, you know, and it squeezed for a lot of us, including myself. I lost my home. But for him, it was his livelihood. It was the way he earned a living. So how he put food on the table. The hand of God was squeezing tight. It was pinching. His response was he yielded to it. They discovered life without electricity, without water, without gas. They discovered how to yield to it and how to deal with it. I still remember that him telling me about how they would take solar power yard lights and they would bring them into the house at night, and that would be how they lit their room up. They would light a fire in the fireplace for warmth, and frequently would sleep there in the wintertime in front of that fireplace and not use bedrooms or anything, just sleep on the floor. And you know what? They played games instead of watching TV. They actually talked to each other. You know, so you get the picture. The hand of God squeezed, they yielded to it, and they discovered the joy in their trial. It produced endurance. And that's what God does. He gets you in a place where you can't do anything but yield, and he pinches you really, really hard. And you think, oh man, what am I going to do? And God says, yield, give in. And if necessary, straighten up. Well, you have to let some of it out sometimes, don't you? Well, look at verse 7. Casting all your anxiety on him. Now, wait a minute. That pinch is not the anxiety. The pain becomes the anxiety. The pinch is the loving hand of God. And the hurt that comes from it is what causes the part that makes you want to scream. And God says, hey, here I am. I'm ready to listen. You and me. Nobody else around. You just let it out. Those anxieties that often come in a trial ought to be poured out to God in your closet before him. Isn't that just a beautiful picture? You know, God says, hey, I don't knock you over the head and expect that you're not going to come out screaming. But if you're going to scream, I expect you to come to me. He wants to hear your anxieties. But why? Look at the rest of verse 7. It tells us. Because he cares for you. He says, I care about that hurt. He says, I want to hear the things that are on your heart. He says, believe me, my child, I am working, I am pinching, I am squeezing, and I'm using all the circumstances that I have at my disposal to develop your character qualities that would never otherwise be exhibited. Now let's go back to James. But before we do, before we go back to chapter 1, I want to look at chapter 5 for a minute. You know, there's a thought that I had in the last few weeks when I was preparing this that I thought might answer some of your questions. And it's important matter that James 5 introduces, and it talks about, I think, the difference between affliction and sickness. I don't want to be confusing, so let me describe it this way. You know, I've been in situations, and I'm sure you have too, you know, where there's been individuals undergoing an affliction, and, you know, we've prayed for him, and you go to him, you know, and you pray, and there's just no relief. And you go, oh, man, there ought to be some relief. And, you know, or in your situation, you think you prayed, and there's no answer. Or the answer is no. And there's other situations where you might be ill. And someone comes and prayed, or through a scalpel, or through a period of time, you know, through the scalpel, you know, whatever the situation is, you've been healed from it, and the answer is yes to your prayer. That's restoration. And I'm of the opinion that there is a certain circumstances that will not end, but they are built within the framework of our being to keep us living on the level of endurance. In other words, I don't think that we have the promise of full restoration in this life from all of its afflictions. Paul is an example of that. Three times he prayed, three times the answer was no. And then he said, Lord, I have learned that your grace is sufficient for me, and I'll live the rest of my days with a quality of endurance. Now, look at verse 13. Is anyone among you suffering? That word means to be smitten, or to some kind of a misfortune or affliction. It's not the normal word that is used for physical pain. James 5:13 asks, has any of you been smitten by a misfortune or afflicted by stress? And then the answer is, then he must pray. Period. No promise of relief. Just let him pray, period. And he prays, and he waits, and it doesn't end. I know this very well. I live with one with this kind of affliction, and we just continue to pray. How about if anyone is sick? The verse goes on. Is anyone cheerful? He is to sing praises. Verse 14, is anyone among you sick? Then he must call for the elders of the church, and they are to pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. What I want to show you is the contrast. There is suffering kind of affliction, and there is a sick kind of affliction. And when undergoing the sick kind of affliction, it is in this category, there can be restoration. But all I find for the sufferer in verse 13 is, let him pray. Now, frankly, I don't find that very bleak because of James 1, verse 5. You can go back there now. James 1, verse 5. In fact, these two things I want to share are the reasons that our troubles overwhelm us. These two reasons are why many of us can't handle the trials. Many of us blow it. First of all, there is a lack of wisdom for which we are to pray. That ties into chapter 5. And so, look at verse 5 here. But if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all generously and without reproach, and it will be given to him. Now, the context of verse 5 is verses 2, 3, and 4. Troubles that just linger. And here you are, surrounded by troubles, and there is no way out. In James 5, it says, pray. In James 1, it says, pray for wisdom. Well, you ask yourself, well, what is wisdom? Wisdom is the ability to view life from God's vantage point. Don't miss that, guys. It is the ability to view life from God's vantage point. The Lord, go, Lord, I ask you right now that in the midst of this loss, the grief, the heartache, or disappointment, or discouragement, or failure, or whatever discouragement I'm in, I ask you right now for wisdom to view it from your viewpoint, and then I ask for faith not to give up. Lack of faith, that's the second point. Verse 6, but he must ask in faith without doubting. Lack of wisdom causes us to be overwhelmed. Lack of faith also causes us to be overwhelmed. Wisdom is gaining God's insight for the test. Faith gives us God's strength to endure the test. I want to say that again. Wisdom is gaining God's insight for the test. And faith gives us God's strength for the test. Now, to me, it's a beautiful description of verses 6 and 7 of a person who wants two wills. And when he goes through the test, look at it. Verse 6, let him ask in faith without doubting. For the one who doubts is like the surf of the sea. I love that description. Driven and tossed by the wind. The opposite of faith is doubt. This isn't faith that saves you. This is faith that sustains you. It means that you don't abandon ship. That's what it means. You just hang in there. You don't abandon yourself to God. It's his safety and his strength. And will you notice that in verse 6 it refers to a man who is driven by the sea and tossed. He won't receive anything from the Lord because he is double-minded. Verse 8, being double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. Ever consider what it means to be double-minded? Well, I believe that especially right here in this text, it refers to someone who wants his will and wants God's will. That's being double-minded. You know, I've only seen this in a video, but I hear this is true. If you want to catch a monkey, and you would tie a gourd to a tree, and you put rice down inside the gourd, and the monkey comes along and he smells the rice. And he comes along and he puts his scrawny little hand in through the neck of the gourd. And he grabs onto the rice. And he's caught. Why is he caught? It's because the dumb monkey won't let go of the rice. He won't remove his hand. He can't because he's got his fist clenched around that rice. He screams and he jumps and he goes all over the place, you know, and then his capturer comes and grabs him. Well, you know, that's the Christian. Down inside that gourd is my will. Now, I want the freedom of living under God's plan, but I want that rice too. And we hang on, and the trials come, and we're not going to give in. We're not going to give in, and it just captures us. And we're finished. And God's trying to say, take your hand out of the gourd. But you won't. You won't get the rice when you do. So you're going to take my plan, or you're going to go under in this test. It's as simple as that. Now, to release the rice, if you please, means wisdom. Knowing I'm better off without that rice. That's what wisdom is. And strength, knowing that I don't need that rice to be happy. So you got it? I think that's great stuff. It's not me. I mean, God put it down here. We just uncovered it. Well, what can you promise a person that lives like that? What can you say to that person that says, okay, I abandon myself to God and I give up the rice and all that goes with it? I just want to live under God's marvelous arrangement, even though it may include a few subways along my life. Okay, verse 12. I can promise you two things: real happiness and real living. First of all, it says in verse 12, blessed is the man who perseveres under trial. The word blessed means to genuinely be happy. You know, back in the Old Testament, it was like happy, happy, happy many times over, you know. When you get your hand out of the gourd, you're going to be happy like you've never been happy before. When that test comes and you say, thank you, Father, for trusting me, that I can handle this. And you say to him, teach me that what it is that I have to learn through this. And the second thing in the verse, the verse goes on, for once he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to those who love him. That's real living. To be sure, there is a future crown for saints that endure because of their love for Christ. But I think there is a temporal crown. It's life itself. And honestly, I believe that the person that really lives in the Christian life is the one that perseveres under that trial. And he doesn't get irritable. He reminds me of a little child's toy. You've probably gotten one for your child, you know? It is weighted on the bottom, and it's like, could be so tall, and you walk up to it and you punch it and it falls down to the ground and vroom, it just bounces right back up. You go back to it again and you punch it and it vroom, it just bounces back up again. Well, it does that because it's designed that way. It's designed to bounce right back up. And so it is with the Christian. A couple of blows, you know, we're flat out, you know, planning to defect. But God comes along and he says, get back on your feet. Trials, they are inevitable. But they are more than inevitable. They are purposeful. And if you will consider, if you will comprehend my plan, he says, if you will cooperate with it, then I will teach you through the presence of faith and in the presence of wisdom how my plan can show you real happiness, real life.